You are listening to a free version of the Majority Report with Sam Steeter. To support this show and get another 15 minutes of daily program, go to majority.fm, please.
The Majority Report with Sam Steeter.
It is Monday, March 4th, 2018-19. My name is Sam Steeter. This is the five-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live steps from the industrially ravaged Gowanus Canal in the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. On the program today, professor of history at New York University, author of The End of the Myth, From the Frontier to the Border Wall in the Mind of America, Greg Grandin will be here. Also on the program today, Trump blames Michael Cohen for his North Korea failure. Rand Paul supposedly, allegedly, going to be the vote to counter Trump's state of emergency. And then buckle up, folks. John Hickenlooper is in. The 2020 presidential candidate drops in with a huge promise of sitting down with Mitch McConnell, straightening all this stuff out. Two guys sitting around having a beer. Meanwhile, Seb Gorka out at Fox. Probably because of AOC's hamburger attacks.
The era of the pajama boy is over.
No charges for Sacramento police who shot and killed unarmed Stephon Clark. Meanwhile, El Salvador has gotten so dangerous now, cops are fleeing the country. House votes on a massive anti-corruption package. And as the Arctic cold hits the Midwest, 23 die in Alabama. As severe storms hit across the South, all this and more on today's program, folks. Of course, we'll also be getting to your calls and IMs. Jamie is out on her Mexican, what is it called? Mexican
fiesta.
Fiesta, I guess. And Michael is just on. It's Michael's
siesta.
Michael's Monday siesta.
Michael Monday.
So there it is. But we do have a special guest in studio coming from Massachusetts. Do you want me to say your name? Does it matter? Joanne?
Another Massachusetts sports fan.
Joanne, another Massachusetts sports fan. So, folks, first off, let me just start by saying I attempted to live stream from the Bernie rally in Brooklyn this weekend to very very little success. In fact, zero success. Although I was able to get out on Instagram. And so if you do not have Instagram or you haven't signed up to follow us on Instagram, listen to Grandpa talk about it this way. Whatever you do to go on Instagram.
Log on to Instagram.
Log on to Instagram and do the thing where you can see our stuff at majorityreport.fm. That's our Instagram handle. Now, of course, I have a couple of Finstas, but I just have those so the Majority Reporter fans can't find me, just in case I'm looking at stuff that's lurid. So, but the Majority Report Instagram has at least, you know, some footage from just where we were at the beginning. It was super cold. And I don't think that you can overestimate how much this cold. I mean, it was a very enthusiastic crowd, and it was a big crowd. I haven't seen any specific numbers. I have a feeling probably around 10,000, but I'm not sure.
I saw 13,000.
Okay, that makes sense to me. And, but I think, you know, if it had been 5 or 10 degrees warmer, I think people would have been nuts. But I know for myself, I was like spending a lot of time going like, doing this, and it was cold, and it got colder as the rally went on. The wind was coming in, the sun got covered up because of the storm that has you know, that came through last night. I guess maybe I'm not sure where that was, but it was very exciting. Some great speakers right before Bernie Sanders, and then here is one clip from that that speech.
Today we say to the 1% and the large profitable corporations in America, listen up because this applies to you. We say to the 1% in large corporations that under a Bernie Sanders administration, you're not going to be getting more tax breaks. Quite the contrary. We're going to end your tax breaks and your loopholes. You are going to start paying your fair share of taxes. We will no longer accept the absurd situation where large multi-billion dollar corporations like Amazon, Netflix, and General Motors pay nothing in federal income taxes. And we're not going to allow these corporations and the billionaires to stash their money in the Cayman Islands and in other tax havens. Yes, the wealthy and multinational corporations will start paying their fair share of taxes. We're going to end austerity for working families and bring a little austerity for the wealthy and the powerful.
That's a nice twist on the program of austerity. It was about a 35-minute speech and really ranged across the board. We'll talk more about it later in the program, but it was super exciting to be at the launch of that campaign. And let me just say this, you know, in terms of the primary, like, you know, I don't think we're going to do our best around here not to get too heavy into the primary too early. But obviously, as people join in the race, there's going to be end up being about another 15. I mean, not another 15, but I have a feeling we're going to have about 15 candidates probably before this is over, maybe more. And but the first debates are in June. And, you know, until then, for the most part, I'm hoping that we're going to be able to just sort of talk about different proposals that are brought up by different candidates. You know, at this point, we've heard stuff from like Cory Booker, the baby bonds proposal, which I think is a pretty good proposal. Elizabeth Warren, I think, to be honest, so far has introduced the most interesting and dynamic proposals when you think about universal child care, and when you think about prescription drugs being manufactured by the U.S. government, talking about generics. And then, of course, I think Klobuchar had said something about
tax-advantaged savings
accounts. Tax-advantaged savings accounts. And, oh, incidentally, we're going to spend time making fun of proposals like that. When John Hickenlooper says that what I'm going to be able to do is sit down with Mitch McConnell and work things out, I'm going to make fun of that because that is that's like Brandon Straka level of delusion. And anybody who can actually go on television and say that is necessarily either completely out of it or just totally lying. And so some of that stuff is we're not going to get treated. But I will say this. We have lost some members because they don't appreciate the fact that we are too Bernie friendly here. It's not that many, but whatever. But and that's fine. If people, you know, I think, you know, at least Michael and I have made it clear, like there's plenty of candidates that we could get with on the Democratic side in the general election. I am, you know, between Bernie and Warren, I think I would be equally happy. Maybe there's other candidates to jump in. I don't know. But here's one thing that, and I don't mind. You don't want to be a member? Don't be a member. But if you email and threaten me with your membership to you know, change the programming, I mean, this hasn't been a problem as much in the past couple of years, but there was a problem with this at other times. I will tell you that I will develop a technology to keep you from listening to even the free show. I will spend my time. I will fire you. You will not fire me. I will fire you. So just don't try and leverage. That is why we have this system here. That is why I never wanted to be sponsored by some type of organization or whatnot. I mean, sure, I would be open to partnerships and whatnot, but because I do not take well to people trying to leverage money. It may be a personality defect, and it may be a little bit more extreme than it probably should be. But so don't email that way. You can email and say, like, I'm sorry, I got to take a break from the show because I'm too supportive of blankety blank and I get uncomfortable with it. Totally get it. But if you email and you go, like, if you guys don't stop blankety blank, I'm going to quit. You're fired. I will fire you. And if I'm in a good mood, I'll tell you. But otherwise, you're just not going to have access to the show. So. And, well, I guess maybe this might be a way to get around that. But it may feel like cybercrime is something that happens to other people, but stealing data from unsuspecting people on public Wi-Fi is one of the simplest ways for hackers to make money. When you leave your internet connection unencrypted, you might as well be writing your passwords and credit card numbers on a huge billboard for the whole world to see. Protect yourself with ExpressVPN. ExpressVPN secures and anonymizes your internet browsing by encrypting your data and hiding your public IP address. For instance, so if you wanted to, let's say, I don't know, if you got fired from being a member on a podcast and wanted to make sure they didn't know it was you, this is what you would use when you were trying to download. But of course, the internet security is the main reason for ExpressVPN. It has easy-to-use apps that run seamlessly in the background of your computer, your phone, your tablet. Turning on ExpressVPN protection only takes one click, and it costs less than $7 a month. ExpressVPN is rated number one VPN service by TechRadar. Comes with a 30-day money-back guarantee. A lot of people go out there now with their phones, and they use, you know, all sorts of different types of public Wi-Fi. Airport, you know, it's free. Great. Except for you try and buy something, you are basically opening yourself up to a whole lot of trouble. You can protect your online activity today. Find out how you can get 3 months free at expressvpn.com/majority. That's expressvpn.com/majority for 3 months free with a 1-year package. Visit expressvpn.com/majority to learn more. Express, expressvpn.com/majority. All right. Lastly, before we get to Greg Grandin, I said my spiel about members who trying to leverage membership for content changes in the show. I don't mind criticism. I just don't like it when, like, people try and leverage that stuff. I do not do well with that. But this was a great email. Dear MR, I started listening to the show 4 years ago. I've been a member for about 3. I was a 28-year-old Taiwanese woman teaching English in my country. I had never left for an extended period of time. Your show not only informed me about politics, but motivated me to pursue it in some fashion. I decided to get a master's degree in Paris, large part because the tuition is literally 260 euros a year, and every student gets housing subsidy regardless of nationality.
Not quite the same at NYU.
Yeah, not exactly the same. My Master 1 thesis is on the Tea Party and conservatism, and my Master 2 thesis is on the right's history of fighting culture wars from Buchanan to Trump. You can see Majority Report's influence all over them. I've just been offered two fully funded admissions into the political science PhD programs at Berkeley and Columbia.
Wow.
And we'll be visiting the campuses next month to decide where to go. I'm writing to thank you guys not only for inspiring me in a passion for politics, but equipping me with insights and perspectives that have helped me come this far. I'm anxious about starting a five-year program at 32, but knowing that MR will be with me every step of the way is a tremendous source of comfort. If I do end up in New York and I get a chance to go to your live shows, I hope to be able to thank you in person. I'm sure there are numerous stories like mine out there, but I thought I'd add to the chorus that you guys are changing lives. And that's from listener Kara. First of all, if you come to New York, come into the studio. But second of all, thank you so much for this email. I almost don't even believe that this is a real person. But it's incredibly sweet and very gratifying. So thank you. All right, we're going to take a quick break. Don't forget, you can support this show by going to jointhemajorityreport.com. Also, justcoffee.coop, fair trade coffee, tea, or chocolate. Use the coupon code MAJORITY, get 10% off. When we come back, the end of the myth. From the frontier to the border wall in the mind of America, Greg Grandin. We are back. Sam Seder on the Majority Report on the phone. It's a pleasure to welcome to the program Professor of History at New York University, best-selling author of Fordlandia, and now his most recent, The End of the Myth, From the Frontier to the Border Wall in the Mind of America, Greg Grandin. Welcome back to the program.
Thanks for having me on again.
So, all right, let's start with because in some respects, I guess this story starts with what you call America's founding paradox. What is that founding paradox?
Well, the founding paradox is the idea of the way the idea of expansion was built into the premise of United States history, that expansion would solve all of the problems inherent in a society founded on the rights of property and individual rights, that early Republican theorists about the concentration of wealth, and then they were worried about very modern problems, the inequality, political monopoly. They were worried, obviously, weren't worried about industrialization yet or things like that. But all of the big problems that go with a society founded on individual rights were understood to also generate serious vectors or venues of corruption, of monopoly control. And they tried to figure out ways to work around that. And what they came up with in very explicit terms was expansion. You extend the sphere and you dilute factionalism. You dilute the tendency of individuals, you know, what we now would call class conflict and class struggle.
So the idea is just keep making the pie bigger, and then you're not going to have people arguing over how much pie they get, because there's just going to be there's going to be pie until infinity, until, of course, you run out of pie. And then the question is,
yeah,
where are you going to get that pie from?
Right, right. Well, eventually there is no more outside anymore, and eventually you hit limits. I mean, there were lots of different ways in which expansion was understood to solve to solve social problems. Expansion was understood to dilute factionalism, dilute class conflict. You can use expansion and the promise of limitless growth to organize domestic politics, to establish what a moral society looked like. And this is a prerogative that's very much unique to the United States. I mean, look, there's been other empires and other expansive nations, but it's hard to think of another country such that has for so long, for centuries, and we're talking about across the landed frontier, and the book is a long history. It's a 300-year history that covers the continental expansion, across the frontier, across the United States, and then other vectors of expansion, military, markets, cultural, political. And it's hard to think of another country that has become so dependent on the promise of unlimited growth in order to solve domestic problems, but also organize domestic politics to kind of create a sense of right and wrong, to transcend contradictions within political constituencies. Foreign policy has been central to U.S. domestic politics for a long, long time.
Okay.
And something that I argue isn't recognized.
Yeah, all right. Well, there's a lot there that so let's just start with that notion of why. I mean, is it as simple because the United States is one of those rare, I guess, countries that had, because of the timing in which it was founded and the amount of natural resources that it had, is that why that attitude is there? Or is it simply because the founding itself was the idea of crossing the Atlantic? I mean, why do you
crossing
think
crossing the Atlantic? Yeah, I think all of those things. I mean, it's not one answer why. It's a bit overdetermined, but certainly the timing, the related to European expansion, Anglo expansion, theological debates and conflicts within Protestantism, between Protestantism and Catholicism, the way that those tensions, theological arguments get played out, where the solution is understood to move forward. The settlers were either going to open up a new front in old world battles, or the new world provided a chance to start anew, errand into the wilderness to provide a model of what a city on the hill looked like. There's many different propulsions, many different things that moving forward, certainly material resources and the fact that the continent was understood to not be held by a sovereign power. Obviously, there were Native Americans, right? And that was and the violence that was visited on Native Americans is part of the process and part of the problem of expansion. But all of those reasons, I think, has to do with the unique history of America and what makes America exceptional.
I mean, and so I guess in some respects, like the journey on the frontier happened, I guess, when they get on the boats from Europe, right?
Even not from Saxony, from right. Saxon Germany. Thomas Jefferson, 3 years before the Declaration of Independence, his very first political tract talked about the right to immigrate, the right to migrate, to pull up stakes. When Saxon freemen didn't want to submit to feudal overlords, they just moved over to the Isles of Britain, and then from Britain to America. So the right to migrate wasn't Jefferson. It was more than just a natural right. It was the condition of natural rights. It made liberty possible because you could just pull up stakes and escape tyranny. And so it was Saxon from Europe to Great Britain to the British Isles, and from the British Isles to the Americas, and then America West. This was before the Declaration of Independence. This was a foundational idea of the right to movement, and in this case, and particularly to move west, was a foundation of what we call modern political liberty.
Okay, so let's when you talk about the idea of expansion being an answer to domestic problems, just for the sake of and there's obviously you cover a lot of examples, but give us one so that folks can sort of move from the conception to the sort of the tangible on that.
Yeah, it's too easy to stay in the abstract. Well, one example is there was a lot of concern about granting suffrage to non-propertied, illiterate white men. What would happen if they voted in socialism? What would happen if they had a majority vote and they voted in some kind of class party or class politics? So the ability to use the land dispossessed by Native Americans during indigenous removal, Indian removal, was key to stopping that problem. Expanding suffrage while not leading to a kind of socialist vote. So you had Jacksonian democracy going hand in hand and being absolutely dependent on Indian removal. You had another very concrete example is the regional factionalism after the Civil War between North and South. That is transcended and overcome in the War of 1898. The War of 1898 is the way in which Southern former Confederate sons and grandsons are reincorporated into U.S. military, fully incorporated. It started earlier than that, but the mission to liberate Cuba from Spanish Empire and the Philippines from the Spanish Empire, from Spanish medievalism, was a way in which Southerners could reclaim not just the space within an expanding nation through the military and through war, but claim the mantle of bringing democracy to the world. And they were able to retranslate their civil war, their secession, which was fought to defend chattel slavery. They were able to reinterpret that as part of this long crusade of bringing liberty to the world. Those are just two examples. But if you actually think about it, there's no progressive movement in the United States moment that hasn't been dependent on expansion. I talked about Jacksonian democracy, the Civil War, the pacification of the West, and the promise of free land was key in building a loyal Union army. The progressives who broke up the trusts were also interested in breaking up the Spanish Empire. The New Deal was dependent on the expansion of foreign markets and winning World War II. Some suffragists traded their support for World War I in exchange for Wilson's support for the right of women to vote. So you can go down the line, and there has been a way in which social reform and the way that ruling coalitions use social reform to establish political legitimacy and hegemony has been absolutely dependent on the ability to move out in the world.
Now, the first example you gave of having this uneducated class of white essentially workers, and how are we going to give them the vote, but also prevent their interests from being misaligned with ours? We're going to co-opt them by giving them property. And on some level, it sounds a little bit like George Bush's ownership society, as it were. But putting that aside, so that one, it seems really explicit, right? And it literally involves physical expansion. The others involve expansion in terms of, I think what we could call now imperialism. How How is the United States unique in that in the, sort of the second regard from other imperialistic? Like, how else would, I mean, because obviously European countries did not necessarily, I mean, I guess maybe on some level, this is what Hitler was thinking in terms of trying to expand Germany. But European nations did not have the opportunity to say, like, oh, we're going to buy off part of our population by giving them, in, you know, what seems to be like a never-ending amount of land that is uninhabited by people that we consider to be people, right? Like, it,
yeah. Well, there has been studies that looked at what they called social imperialism, the ability to use empire and colonialism to buy off a working class in different ways. But what's unique about the United States is one, the denial of colonialism, right? That it's an, you know, it's an expansive power that became the single most powerful polity in world history, while being able to credibly deny that it is an empire or it is a colonial power. So there's the inbuilt denial mechanism, but there's also the kind of concept of freedom, which I think is very unique to the United States, right? This move across the West of expanding a greater liberty for white men by basically putting down people of color, either through chattel slavery, their labor, or taking their land, Native Americans, or taking territory from Mexico. And then, so moving west and claiming a larger liberty by putting down people of color, but then defining that liberty in opposition to people of color. Freedom was understood as freedom from restraint. And I think that's one of the key things that is that's particular to the United States is self-conception of itself, right? A notion of individualism and freedom defined as a minimal state and freedom from restraint, and that I think is one of the key things that's different from maybe other British colonial powers that developed a more socialized. They dealt more directly with the labor question, with the class question, with the social question and the emergence of class politics and social democratic politics, which in the United States has been long absent.
Okay, and so we have this this like sort of fundamental, I guess, psychological, maybe is too reductive, but this character, this national character that involves expansion as a means in which to solve problems, at least domestic problems, and then once we run out of territory, we need to start to expand in terms of, if not in capturing territory, but in capturing resources and hegemony around the world. And then once that becomes sort of less, more and more difficult to do, and I guess that changes too, from it's less about ships and more about, maybe to some extent about ships, but less about ships and air forces and more about like capturing markets. But at one point that becomes, it's just the world is finite. And so what happens is it bounces back in on us. Is that basically what happens?
It does bounce back. And there's different ways in which expansion has, you know, across the continent and the idea of the frontier and the way the frontier itself becomes a term unique to the United States and becomes more of a state of mind and a site of existential creation and the way then the word frontier is used to discuss other forms of expansion, be they through war into the Philippines or market expansion. And there's been moments of limits, right? There's been other moments in which the U.S. hits the wall, so to speak, right? Because in some ways it's a subjective wall. There was the Great Depression of the 1930s and the emergence of the New Deal. And then and in some ways the New Deal was very much steeped in a lot of the kind of argumentation surrounding the frontier pieces. A lot of New Deal thinkers understood the United States as reaching the end of the frontier. And then so they began to socialize. I mean, they basically affixed the word social on all of these old categories, social democracy, social rights, social civilization, social education, social medicine. And so there's different ways of dealing with hitting the hitting a wall and the New Deal and the development of a kind of new ethos of social citizenship was certainly part of the New Deal success. But then the U.S. also hit a wall in the 1970s with Vietnam and the response to and Vietnam and the energy crisis and the limits to growth and all of that politics of scarcity that emerged in the mid to late 1970s. And the response then was Reaganism, was once again restoring a notion of freedom as freedom from restraint, right? So there was one of Reagan's energy advisors, they asked him what the agenda was, you know, in 1980. And he said, the agenda is more, more, more. You know, it's basically, you know, we're going to respond to limits by pretending there are no limits and pushing outward. And Reagan was successful in doing that because he could push into the third world that was economic nationalist, that could be rolled back. That was, you know, he cut taxes, but then jacked up military spending and restructured the political economy of the United States. And that lasted for a while. But now it does seem we've hit another limit. And this one, to me, seems less subjective and more objective. You know, there's the endless war, there's the economic stuff, but then there's the environmental crisis, which seems to me not a matter of interpretation, but it seems to me really the end of the promise of limitlessness.
If I understand this, you know, when they were looking at in the New Deal, they basically said we found a new frontier, and that frontier is a new America where we perceive we really socialize some of these problems, and we enter into an era where we as a society can tackle things that we, you know, did not as a society had the awareness or the strength or the courage to tackle as a society in some ways, right?
I think that's absolutely right. I think that a lot. I mean, Franklin Delano Roosevelt took classes with Friedrich Jackson Turner, the person who basically cobbled together what we know as the frontier thesis. And Roosevelt was unbelievably skilled at giving like a 2-minute preface of the frontier thesis. And then, you know, that U.S. wealth was based on expansion and being able to move on. And then you could just say, you know, but those days are gone, you know, in like 4 words, you know, he just summed up a whole new political universe, you know, a political, sense of possibility and responsibility.
And that had a certain durability as far as it went. I mean, we didn't travel quite as far into that new frontier, I think, maybe as some had hoped at that time. But was Reagan's real? In other words, was, you know, like I say, I don't know. People can argue about the durability of the idea, of the concept of the New Deal, because it's sort of, you know, it remained in some ways static for a while anyways. But was Reagan's a real, I mean, I understand the sales pitch.
Was Reagan's a real realignment?
Well, not just a realignment, but was there really a new frontier that Reagan was offering? Or was it just simply like, I'm going to pretend there is?
Well, it's a good question, right? I mean, it depends, you know, it depends on what level of interpretation. You know, I would argue that Clinton and Obama were clearly working within the limits and framework that Reaganism set up. I mean, Reaganism was fundamentally negative, right? It was a new right organized against prayer in school, against environmentalism, against gay rights, against abortion, against a whole. It was fundamentally negative in nature. But it also, I think Reagan's success and Reaganism's success is that they were able to turn that negativity into what they imagined to be a positive vision of freedom, because it had such deep roots in American political culture. Freedom as freedom from restraint, right? There is no
government.
Limit.
Government
is
an obstacle.
I think
government's an obstacle,
yeah,
and we just unshackle ourselves from government.
Yeah, so I think it was fundamentally negative in nature, but I think that its success was that it was able that we, that Reagan and Reaganism was able to transform it into a positive ideology and a new common sense that we're still fighting to break out of in many ways.
In some respects, it was sort of like, we're going to return to the old deal. And
That's what it was. I mean, they were definitely going back to the pre-New Deal vision of freedom as freedom from restraint, as opposed to, I mean, you know, and it's not just FDR, but Rex Tugwell and Harry Wallace and Francis Perkins, they all drew on the frontier thesis to basically critique the frontier thesis and come up with this, yes, a kind of unlimited frontier or a belief in unlimited frontier created these realms of political wealth and economic wealth that were unprecedented, but those days are gone. And we now have to kind of create a new ethos of social responsibility. And they call bureaucracy. I mean, the person who was put in front of the National Recovery Administration that was eventually ruled unconstitutional, but it might've been the most radical aspect of the New Deal. He was a general, Hugh Johnson. He called the NRA the new frontier. He was born in Oklahoma, so he knew what the real frontier was. And Hugh Johnson called the NRA the new frontier. This is the frontier now, government bureaucracy, and he meant it in a positive way.
Right, and we should say the National Recovery Administration,
That's what I meant.
All right. Well, so let's talk about how that brings us to the wall, and maybe we need to back up a little bit, at least temporarily, because there are the wall is. There are sort of three elements to the history of this. Right. It's like how immigrants and really, I guess, two elements, but maybe three, like the immigrants and the sort of the militarization of the border and the idea of like we need some type of structure there. Walk us through that history of immigration and how it, you know, interplays with that notion of frontier.
Well, there are these multiple ways of thinking of how we reach this moment, this politics of border brutalism. And one of them is a kind of bipartisan militarization and criminalization of immigration. And it, without going too thick into the weeds, we went from a system that was relatively open where there was no frontier. I mean, I'm sorry, was no border, and Mexicans came seasonally to work in the Southwest and Midwest cities and Los Angeles and New York, to increasingly that stream being divided into a legal stream through guest worker programs, bracero, and a criminalized stream. And the history of the 20th century in some ways is the growth of the criminalized stream and the turning into a trickle, the legal stream. And there's lots of different markers for this. Mexico didn't have quotas for a long time about how many visas it could give out. Then quotas were finally put on in 1965. But this all goes into your point that there was a kind of bipartisan Republican and Democratic consensus or policy towards militarization of the border. It was very much tied in with NAFTA. NAFTA signed by Bill Clinton into law in late 1993 went hand in hand with some of the most explosive growth of the Border Patrol and the militarization of the border. There's that history, but then there's also the history of the kind of more explicit nativism that comes out of the country's history of white supremacy and how the border even as the frontier was being held up as this venue in which the United States becomes more liberal, moves out into the world, is the symbol of a threshold into the future, the border was concentrating a lot of the racist violence. Obviously, there was racism and Jim Crow laws and in other places in the United States, but one axis of racist violence was the border with Mexico. And the KKK in the 1920s, then again the KKK in the 1970s, a lot of the kind of radicalization and extremism that happens in war, when veterans came back radicalized to the right, would find release on the border or expression on the border. My argument is that has long relatively been contained to the border itself. But what Trumpism, you see a kind of explosion of that, of nationalization of that border brutality.
Before we get to that nationalization of the border brutality, is that like the flip side of the frontier, in the sense that, like, if the idea is that we want this ever increasing pie and we've got to go different places to find it, and sometimes we've got to invent a new pie, as it were, that the idea of immigrants and immigration, they start nibbling away at the pie and make it harder for us to, you know, sort of claim that it's ever increasing.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's the opposition of polarity that I'm trying for in the book. I mean, the frontier is always at the same time a border, even if it's not talked about as a border, but that, you know, the border but then the frontier itself becomes this symbol of a multilateral universalism, the idea of endless growth, the idea of a certain kind of liberal universalism, that everybody can sit at the table, that all boats can be lifted, that you can organize politics. And of course, there's some truth to this. The United States, after World War II, does organize becomes an unprecedented world power, in which it economically develops the countries that it conquered and defeated, with the idea that you're going to expand capitalism and the United States will benefit from that expansion. But at the same time, the border is, you know, there's different expressions of nativist racism in the United States, but one of them is certainly directed towards Mexicans. But the border doesn't necessarily become a nationalized symbol of the opposite of frontier universalism until recently, but it has been. That's exactly the tension. What Trump says is there isn't enough to go around. We have to take care of our own. It's a kind of return to what some people call a race realism that has long current, deep currents in U.S. political culture, but has always remained marginal or marginalized. And now we've seen it, and we could talk about why, but it's become nationalized in Trumpism.
Well, yeah, let's talk about why, because I'd also like to talk about, like, you know, what that suggests in terms of what kind of language can recreate. I mean, if we're stuck in this paradigm that Americans need to have this sense, and maybe I guess we saw it, like, you know, with space too on some level, right? This paradigm that Americans really have to have this sense that there is a frontier for them, even if it's, you know, sort of a metaphorical one. But why has that happened? I mean, what do you think has led to that sort of to what Trump has been able to sort of either tap into or promote?
Well, it goes back to the question of Reagan and how Reaganism was a restoration of an older ethos of limitlessness and the way that that Reaganism continued in different political projects, whether it be what some people call neoliberalism, or some people call neoconservatism, an emphasis on militarism. But in any case, those projects are exhausted. The end of the kind of sense that the U.S. can use its military to remake, not just remake the world, but that remaking itself would provide moral purpose, that the mission was sanctified, I think reached its limit with Iraq, right? Afghanistan and Iraq, and not just the financially draining, endless war that the United States thrust itself into, but the morally discrediting, you know, there's in the book, I kind of index the rise of border militia movements to Abu Ghraib, right? Just around the time, you know, just when the whole kind of project is revealed to be a sham and a fraud on a staggering level. I think another kind of limit is the economic model, the neoliberal model. 2008 was the financial crisis, and was supposedly in a recovery, but it's a perverse recovery. It's stockpiled wealth and revealed inequality and social immobility, And so in both of them, whether it's markets or militarism, the promise of endless growth can no longer be used to kind of organize domestic politics. And then hovering over all of this is climate catastrophe, right? I mean, the literally the frontier is on fire. The large, enormous swaths of the West are burning. Insects are disappearing and bats are disappearing in record numbers. The ocean is acidifying. I think that the real limit that hovers over this is the climate crisis, and that's why I said where, you know, some of these other moments of limits were maybe more subjective or where we seem to be in a moment where there's no going back to that promise of limitlessness as a way to respond to social problems.
So if I understand this, it's almost like we don't have the opportunity for growth, all right? I mean, use it like as a metaphor is like I can't increase my income, but I can increase my savings. And if I stop expending in this way, and on some level, there's this perception that immigration is some type of expenditure of our bodily fluids, our precious bodily fluids,
yeah,
in some way as a nation.
So it's tempting to see the wall as some kind of disenchantment of the myth, right? Like it's a better reflection of the way the world works. There really are limits, and the wall is saying that there are limits. And not just that there are limits, that you can't use the promise of limitlessness as a promise for domestic politics. So the wall is a recognition that that not everybody will rise up, not everybody will sit at the table, that we have to take care of our own. But I think that that's only half of the story. I think the wall is its own form of enchantment, right? Because it's a kind of it gives sanction to the kind of petulant cruelty and hedonism that is Trumpism, right? I mean, there's a lot of symbols of this rolling coal, the idea of just like, yeah, there. In the face of the climate crisis, which to me represents a true universalism, we really are all in this together. The response is, I'm going to do whatever I want. We're going to build a wall, and then we're going to engage in these acts of cruelty and hedonistic displays of brutality, whether it be against migrant children or families. I mean, there's lots of different ways in which Trump, the cultural cruelty of Trump is on display. But I would argue that, yes, it's against migrants, and particularly against Mexican and Central migrants, that it's most consistent and most spectacular in a way.
So it's like, I mean, it's fascinating because, it's rare you stop to think about, like, why does the wall, and I guess this is what you've done, but why is it so interesting? Like, what's the material benefit that the wall gives to its most ardent supporters? And it sort of feels like the wall and all of what you're talking about, this sort of like cruelty and brutality, it almost gives that same feeling as that, classic, I've got elbow room here, and an endless sky type of situation.
Yeah. I mean, going back to the days when the Puritans arrived, like a sense of aloneness and independence is only predicated on genocide and elimination of the people who are already there. So there's a long history of this. But yes, I think the wall is, I think what is so fascinating about the wall is the way it is, it's exact opposite of the frontier. I think it taps deep into these cultural symbols and mythologies of U.S. politics. And in some ways, I know a little while ago there was some talk in the media about how Trump just stumbled on the wall. His advisors told him to use it as just a way of remembering something. I mean, I think that undersells the resonance and the way it resonates within this kind of nativist traditions, which again have always been present. The United States is an expansive expanding settler colonial nation founded on slavery and genocide. So all of that violence is always there. But my argument is that ongoing expansion has kept it on the margins, kept it at the border, so to speak. And now what we're seeing is, you know, now that it can no longer be kept at the, you know, no longer, the violence can no longer be kept on the fringes, is now kind of all-consuming, you know, consuming national politics and attention.
Greg Grandin, the book is The End of the Myth, From the Frontier to the Border Wall in the Mind of America. It's fascinating stuff. Thank you so much for your time today. I really appreciate it.
Thank you so much for having me on again. Appreciate it. Have a nice day.
You too. All right, folks. That is all the time for our first and free half of our program.
Some frontier thesis.
Yes. It's fascinating that there's that, again, that paradox where you would imagine a wall is the opposite of the frontier, but it provides sort of the subtext carries through. Folks, speaking of the final frontier, that is, we have hit a frontier of sorts, or the end of the frontier for some of you. For others, I can offer an expansive frontier.
Some of you are going to hit the wall pretty soon.
Some of you are about to hit the wall. But some of you will continue with us onto the fun half. You can join those in this new frontier by going to jointhemajorityreport.com. Jointhemajorityreport.com for just pennies a day. You can join us in this new world called the fun half. Who wouldn't want to live there? In the fun, where it's fun all the time.
And it's not even settler colonial.
No. No, it's internet time. So it's completely, it really is untraversed. Also, justcoffee.coop, fair trade coffee, tea, or chocolate. Use the coupon code MAJORITY, get 10% off. Great company. Really care about the farms that provide them with coffee in a way that I don't think any other coffee roaster can or does. And not to mention, it's great coffee. So use the coupon code MAJORITY. Go to justcoffee.coop, C-O-O-P. Tomorrow night, if Michael recovers, there'll be the Michael Brooks show. This is always, you never know. He always manages to recover by Tuesday. It's interesting.
It's like, yeah, exactly. It's a Michael Jordan flu game every Tuesday.
That's really weird. Really weird. But, you can check out the Antifada. I imagine they're still, their podcasts are still up, despite the fact that they are out of the country. Matt. Decides to show up, work.
In-person plug.
There you go.
Literary Hangover, we did a short story by Nathaniel Hawthorne called Wakefield. We listened to the full thing. It's about a guy who decides to leave his wife one day and moves across the street so he can just watch her react to his absence over the course of 20 years. And
wow, that's fascinating. Does he just disappear?
Well,
just ghost?
I guess I'll just spoil it. He does return.
Well, no, but I'm saying, did he tell her when he
left?
Oh,
no, he said, I'll be back Friday. And he just blew right by that Friday. And then
went out to get cigarettes.
Next 20 years of Friday.
Wow.
Yeah.
And he moved across the avenue?
Yeah, he wanted to be able to see her. And there's at one point where he's like, oh, it looks like she's really taking this hard. And there's like a doctor that comes and then she recovers from that and starts going on with her life.
Oh, good for her. And this guy's just skulking around the neighborhood, I guess, not to be seen.
Yeah, exactly.
Jesus. Sounds like fun. All right. 646-257-3920 is the number. See you in the fun half.